welcome Chair of the AnitaB.org Board of Trustees, Dr. Fran Berman.
You look beautiful. Give yourself a hand. Let's give another hand to Debbie. Debbie is amazing. I was just chatting it with her backstage, and I'm going to go and give her my home address, so when she's through with that skirt, it will come to me. It's great to see you. As chair of the AnitaB.org Board of Trustees, I'm really happy to be here today. Like it is with many of you, Grace Hopper is one of my very favorite events of the year. And it's a chance for us all to get together, to support each other, to wine with each other, to provide opportunities for each other, and to really make this profession really important for all of us. So before I introduce an amazing woman who will be our next speaker, my very good friend, Dr. Justine Cassell, the AnitaB folks, yeah, way to go, Justine. I will tell you about her in a moment. But before that, the AnitaB folks asked me to just say a few words because this is the end of my term as the chair of the Board of Trustees for AnitaB. So I just wanted to thank two amazing groups of people. So the first amazing group of people I wanted to thank in front of all of you and with all of you is the Board of Trustees and the AnitaB.org staff themselves. Go to the website, look at who they are. This is an amazing group of rock stars. They're generous with their time, they're passionate about us, they care about us. It takes a village to make a leader, and I am so grateful to every single one of them for what we've all been able to do on your behalf. And the second group of people I want to thank is all of you, because as you know, it takes a village to make a professional. And that's something we do for each other. And I have to say, in all the years I've been coming to Grace Hopper, which have been incredibly important years for me, you all have been there. I've run into you in the halls. We've talked to each other about all kinds of things. You're a really important part of my life, and I really want to thank you all for everything you do every day. You're an inspiration, so thank you. So now I want to tell you about another one of my inspirations, Dr. Justine Cassell. And so get ready for many, many titles. Justine is Associate Dean of Technology Strategy and Impact in the School of Computer Science at Carnegie Mellon University. She's Director Emerita of the Human-Computer Interaction Institute. She co-directs the Yahoo-CMU InMind Partnership on the Future of Personal Digital Assistants, and she's done many, many things. Justine has been on the faculty of Northwestern. Any Northwestern people here? Where she founded the Technology and Social Behavior Doctoral Program and Research Center, and she's also been on the faculty of MIT Media Lab. MIT people? Justine's work in human-human conversation, human-computer interaction, and storytelling has had tremendous impact. Her focus has been on using technology to empower others, and those others have spanned the spectrum from children with autism, where she's worked on the development of embodied conversational agents, to our own community of women, where her book, From Barbie to Mortal Kombat, Gender and Computer Games, go get it right now, explored the relationship between women and computer games. Her work has won her many prizes, including the MIT Edgerton Prize, the AnitaB.org Women of Vision Abbey Award, and many others. One thing that you probably don't know is that Justine and Tracy Camp and I were ACM Distinguished Lecturers in China in 2009. We went all over China, we gave talks. I was so impressed by Justine's scholarly contributions, and more important, or perhaps at least as important, her knowledge of food. So Justine is the ultimate foodie. If she ever asked you to dinner, I would say go. So without further ado, please welcome to stage an incredible technologist, a wonderful friend, and the ultimate foodie, Dr. Justine Cassell.
Well, I'm still looking for a way to bring my two loves together, food and listening to people's voices through technology. And I haven't found a way, but if you have ideas, please come up to me afterwards and tell me what you're thinking about. So, over the course of this week, it's been impossible to avoid what's happening in the world. We can't not think about it. And I don't want to not talk about it. And as the days have gone by, I've realized that I do what I do because I have a commitment. And in my case, the commitment is to making a world where everybody's voice is heard. And I have a skill, which is artificial intelligence and human-computer interaction and stuff like that. And so I put it in the service of listening to human voices, making sure that the most marginalized population, children in developing countries, children, period, women, people of color around the world, are all at the table and their voices are at the table. And what I'm going to talk about today is how I do that through using AI and human-computer interaction and basically everything else I can get my hands on to make that dream come true. I study how people talk to one another and how they collaborate and what it means to collaborate and to be close to and cooperate and to do that through the bonds that we establish with other people. And how do we make sure that in our future, technology preserves those values that we care most about, the bonds between people, and doesn't destroy them? Now, of course, I was on a radio program a number of years ago, and a syndicated national public radio program, and the host said, "So you must do this because you're a girl." Can you guess my response? It wasn't, "Thank you." And it wasn't, "Fuck you," although that was what came first to mind. What I said was, you know, to have been told I was difficult my whole life long, that I'm a problem, that I'm loud and pushy, in the words of Dr. Anita Hill, that I move cones. To be told that as I get more and more senior in my job, that I don't deserve or shouldn't be put in positions of power or authority because I am just too hard on the people I work with and too loud and too problematic. To live with that and still go forward, I can get over any obstacle. And that's what leads to innovation, which is why I'm working at the forefront of my field. So I said this, and in the booth, in the sound booth, everyone in the booth went, "Yes!" I don't think the guy was very liked. So I'm going to talk to you about rapport, about this bond between people, and I want to start with a video that shows you what I mean by using technology to elicit from people who they truly are, their authentic selves.
Alex. Uh-huh. You be the teacher, and I answer questions.
Okay. First question. Do you think it needs to be high up or low?
I think it should be a little low, but a teensy little bit high.
Why?
Because if it is really, really low, you're not going to be able to see it. But if it's really, really high, you're not going to be, it's going to touch the clouds. He's going to touch the moon.
Now, what you see there is a kid being a kid. And that's what we want the world to look like, because kids are kids and they should be allowed to be kids. And they should be allowed to speak however they want. And what we discovered was building virtual children rather than building virtual teachers. Children who spoke like children, who spoke even the dialect that the children spoke, led to higher science gains. And that's the kind of thing I'm interested in, because in most areas of life, and although people don't tell you this, social skills are what get work done. And we have to remember that, and we have to remember it when we build technology. Why when we build technology? Because we cannot get work done when every person in a company is in a different country unless we know how to build bonds across time and space. We can't get work done unless we know how, over time, to become closer and closer to the people around us. And our technology that's in our pockets every day needs to know how to do the same thing. So I use a different methodology from most people. I start with people. And that's not necessarily common in the field of computer science. I videotape people in all kinds of situations. And after this talk, you're never going to be the same. You're never going to go into a cocktail party the same way. I look at people, and I have this terrible skill. I hate it. I can always tell when two people have slept together. And I really don't want to know most of the time, because I dissect videos by 30th of a second increments, and I look at every eyebrow raise, every movement of the body. And I turn that set of observations into something I can analyze. And that analysis really is 30th of a second, every movement of your body. And it's that analysis that lets me come up with a theory of human behavior that can be built into computers. Now, these days, people say, but that's so old-fashioned. It's GoFi. It's good old-fashioned AI. Where's the machine learning? And of course, we do use machine learning. We use a lot of machine learning. We do a lot of sequence mining to tell what predicts the bonds between two people and whether, when we build that into computers, it also predicts the bond between a person and a computer. Why? Not because we want to spend the rest of our lives talking to computers, although we do seem to spend a lot of our lives talking to computers, but because we want our lives to have those skills that we care most about, wherever we are and whomever we're talking to. So the deep learning that we use allows us to analyze, but it isn't the be-all, end-all. And I think for those of us who work on machine learning, we need to remember this. We need to bring in knowledge about human behavior. We can't stop just because there isn't a big data set. So there's my ML rant. So this is the kind of thing we do. We look at kids interacting with other kids, and we sequence mine. That is, we look for places where children's interaction with other children leads to better performance on peer tutoring. In this particular instance, it's looking for curiosity, instances of curiosity, because curiosity leads to creativity, leads to innovation, and yet schools today that depend on grade results and tests for their funding are systematically killing curiosity. And we're going to be in a really bad place if we keep doing that. So I said this allows us to come up with theories, and this also differentiates the kind of work that I would call human-centered AI, because we don't look at somebody and say, oh, I'll build that. Even better, we don't look at ourselves and say, I'm a guy who kind of hangs out, I like playing games, I'll build for people like me. No, because the user's not like me. The people we build for are not us. And so it's human data that allows us to come up with a theory that allows us to build a piece of technology. And by the way, the user is not like me, the user is not like me, the user is not like me. That's the theme song of our master's program in human-computer interaction. So when we implement then, in what I do today, although this hasn't always been the case, I build a lot of virtual humans, and they look like all kinds of things. For the most part, although not all of them are that way in what you see here, this goes back 20 years, we try to build systems that are gender ambiguous and ethnicity ambiguous, so that we don't inadvertently build in some really ugly stereotypes into the technology that we let loose into the world. And then we evaluate those implementations, and the answer is always, wow, that really sucked. Because that's science. You look at something, you get some data, You build something. You give it to real people to use, not just your office mates and not just the people down the hall. And then you say, you know, it's not really doing what I want it to do. It's not getting people to talk. It's talking at people. And once again, my goal is to build technology that listens to everybody's voices, and that allows us to bring everybody's voices to the table. And I never do a great job, certainly not in the first pass or the second or the third. And so that evaluation is what allows us to go back to the drawing board and to start again. And I want to show you an example now. I talked yesterday about a number of the different kinds of pieces of work that I've done in education, math tutoring, in bringing curiosity to children despite what happens in their classrooms, preparing children for literacy. Now I'm lucky enough to work with Dr. Amy Ogan and our joint PhD student Michael Medeo on using non-smartphones in the Ivory Coast to bring education to the children of cocoa workers who are themselves often cocoa workers. How do we do that? But sometimes I get asked to do a project, and it becomes kind of a pet project. And this is a case where the World Economic Forum asked us to build a system to bring to Davos. It was the very first time that technology had been demoed inside the World Economic Forum at Davos with tons of world leaders. And they said, build a woman assistant not too sexy. So that's Sarah, the socially aware robot assistant. And I'm going to show you a video of Sarah. And what you're going to see in this video is Sarah automatically assessing her bond with people and changing her language in real time to increase that bond in order to be able to help them.
It's such a pleasure to meet you. Might I ask your name?
Hey, Sarah. My name is Fedi.
Nice of you to take the time to stop by. So how are things?
It's going pretty good.
So this is the system automatically assessing what the person has said and its impact on rapport, and then showing that rapport
Great.
Just went up because Sarah asked him a question.
Well, let me introduce
And then deciding
myself.
What to say.
I've been asked to play matchmaker by helping attendees find sessions to attend and people to meet based on their interests. All you need to do is tell me a little bit about yourself and what you want to do while you're here.
So I'm a master's student at Carnegie Mellon University in the computer science department, and my research focuses on artificial intelligence and natural language processing.
I've never met someone like you before. It's refreshing.
Oop, this relationship
is my favorite
went up.
Part. Let's see if we can find some interesting people to meet. Just 1 minute while I look this up.
Google Glass.
There are details on the screen about Justine Cassell. I feel you share some
what
interest.
A surprise.
I can either send a message on your behalf suggesting a meeting, or I can give you the information and you can set up the meeting yourself. Would you like me to send the message?
Yeah, please do.
Oh, good. You'll see a message from me in your top link private message inbox introducing you to.
Awesome.
I understand you are busy, so I can let you go if you want. But before you do, want me to take a quick selfie of us?
Yeah, sure, let's do it.
Okay, 1, 2, 3, smile.
You've never seen anything as funny as the president of a country coming back and saying, my selfie didn't turn out so well. Would you mind if I did another one? Okay. So this is a media-worthy example, but it shows what happens when we ask people to talk about themselves. When we make technology that tries to make room for people to talk. And I hope that as time goes on, it's going to make room for all of us to talk, to feel, to relate, to collaborate and cooperate. Something Dr. Hill said this morning really struck me. She said there's still not room for women to be sad or angry. and a technology that lets us all be angry enough not to let anybody else predict the future, but to make it come true, that's what we're here for. So don't predict the future. Make it happen, and make it a future where all of us are at the table. Thank you.